by interconnectedness.
Wow.
The general term for...
would there be?
Could it show a logos?
Yeah.
Would it follow that when particular solar systems reach a certain stage of development, that communication between them is possible? Good beginning. Good. Let me check. I'll give you some help. And if so, if so, well, go ahead. And if there is such a thing as an intelligent life, therefore. Does that suggest if there is such a thing, there may be communication between different solar systems and different galaxies?
There's different classes of civilization.
Yeah, different classes of civilization. Yeah.
That first it reaches the stage of its planetary level, so able to harness the energy of the planetary system, and then the solar system.
That's right.
And then galactic system. But that's really in terms of incorporating energy, as far as communication goes. I mean, take us, for example, we can send our radio waves are now traveling since So theoretically, we can communicate with something that's 70, 80 light years away.
Yeah.
But that's still not far enough to really reach.
Well, that's why what's interesting about that is this word. It's an if. Right? It's an if proposition. It may be terribly disruptive. I put my coffee down and I think
it's not
someone.
Here.
Oh, good. I thought that was yours.
My name on it. No, it's
yours. Okay. I just put on the web. And on the Noetic Society, a new film that was made in 2017, this year, accumulating all of the data that has been available through the Freedom of Information Act. And therefore, they then went on an exploration of all of the UFO sightings, where and what evidence there might be that they do exist, and if that evidence shows some degree of intelligence, what are they doing with it? And they then included in the film key players at these major installations where they had the silos with the ICBMs, with warheads. And these gentlemen, captains of this and majors of this, they then volunteered that at key points in our history, these UFOs went by and disrupted the entire communication network that existed to support the firing of the missiles. That interesting? And also, from the Russian side, they now have evidence since the collapse of the communist state that occurred, that they were following the same thing, because one of their rockets, ICBMs, was then sent on a long-range missile. It was followed by a UFO and was disrupted. They knocked it down. So in any case, this film, which is really interesting, I posted that you can go take a look at it, and it's on the web, so enough of that. So I thought I'd tell you about it. Now let's see whether we can find a different kind of intelligence in the universe exhibiting itself through dreams, shall we? Who's got a dream?
I have a bold dream.
Anyone have any other dreams for tonight?
Fun.
Good. So let's start off with a couple of questions. Yeah, go ahead, Sean.
Good question?
Yeah. Yeah, that's why I asked.
One that I brought up to David the other day, in fact, which is, you were studying last Saturday at the Pathologos, like the conditions that a person must be in to believe the Pathologos and why it's in place. I was wondering, if the Pathologos exists, does it have a providential aspect to it?
If the Pathologos exists, does it have a providential aspect to it?
Yes, it does.
Like, so what is
it? Wait a minute. But it's particular to the family's Pathologos.
What do you mean?
they've gained through doing this very thing. She now became a member in the family and knew how to operate from that point on. They
yes.
see that as an advantage. They
well,
see that as a good.
So that makes a confidential business?
No. The most difficult thing to grab in this game is that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the origin of a personal problem and enlightenment. That's central.
Because
remember what we just found?
I should have at the end, but
right. How did her parents appear in these scenes? Ideal.
Knowing.
Right? Powerful. Come on. Knowing. Knowing.
Revealing.
Good. What was best for her?
Right. Best for her. They appeared most ideal, just like an enlightenment experience. Therefore, the origin of personal problems follows the same dynamics as enlightenment experiences, only it's true for the family, not for the universe.
So, where did that enlightenment experience come in?
No. Would you agree that some people have enlightenment experiences? Oh, then, therefore, there's no such thing as an enlightenment experience for you.
I don't know. I hear about them, but I was wondering how it came up here.
No. Come on. State of the logic. Is this seen as a... See, this has to happen before the age of reason. The child cannot reach the point of reason. It has to be early in their life. This is a five-year-old sin. So,
yeah.
Right. The best years for the introduction of a problem is 3 to 5. Then a different class of problems take place later. But for the child, how does the child experience this? As they're knowing, revealing, they're showing what's best for oneself. Is it likely that in enlightenment experience, someone thinks they're seeing knowing, they're discovering knowing?
I don't know.
Well, you mean you've heard about enlightenment experiences?
I've read that people have them, but I don't know what that is.
No. All I'm asking
I've
is...
I've heard people talk about having an experience of the universe being
Hey, this is unifying. Wait a minute. This is unifying. From this point on, this child knows they're a member. They fit into a unity. They now understand what's going on in the family.
But she's cut off from that.
Pardon? Well, but that's going to be her role in the family.
She's a condition for it.
That role includes
her. She's now a loyal member of the family.
So,
would you agree that
other people that are unified?
No, look here. You have to stay and look for parallels.
Okay.
Right? Do people who have enlightened experiences attribute their experience to something that they've been taught or been exposed to? Yes or no? Okay, then I can't talk to you.
Okay.
I mean, if you don't know, I can't push what I think. Oh, then you do know.
Beyond some law.
Oh. Oh. So then they gain a certain kind of knowing.
Yeah.
Thank you. Then that's over here. Okay? Then they experience some kind of knowing. Do they identify with the system they're in?
No, they go beyond it.
Yeah. No, but do people have an enlightened experience in Buddhism become Jews? Or do they become Hindus? Or do they identify with whatever system they find?
I think if they drop sins, they tend to drop them. Beliefs fall away, they accumulate more.
Do they have a new kind of unity? Come on, more. They have then a new knowing, a new kind of unity. Do they think they've reached the good?
Yeah.
Does it give them a new direction? Yes or no?
Yeah.
Can all of these things be said in this experience? Do they gain a new sense of unity with the family? Do they then become a member of that unitary family? Do they pick on a role?
Yeah, they see they're okay.
Okay means what?
Okay, they see it. So.
They pick up a role here too? They then identify with moving in a certain direction? Well, you don't know. You don't have to take it. But it's very rare then for an enlightened person to take on a particular role as a consequence of having the enlightenment experience. Is that right?
Well, I think they see themselves participating in the rest of the world in a certain way.
Oh, new way, new role? Well, then that's the role. So in the same way, is this a new role?
You ever seen the whole and their part?
Yeah. Are we getting a lot of similarities?
Yeah.
Oh, can you risk the opinion that maybe personal problems emerge from the religion of the family on the same model as enlightenment does, among others? Only this is a phony, this is a pseudo, because you have to be naive and young to accept this as reality, because had she said at that moment, "Hey, Mom and Pop, what are you getting so goddamn upset about? Oh, come on. Why don't you have a cup of coffee and talk to my ex the way he should be talked to? What are you being so... Right? Can't do that to 5-year-old. Therefore, it has to take place. If you don't know it, you can't make this comparison. What follows if this is true? If this idea is true? For you? The whole family.
It's all there.
That's right.
And they're taking our little pictures.
That's right.
And they've got it.
Yeah.
Which is, at some level, life and enlightenment.
That's right.
Life
is the key word. Not truly, but life. It's life. It has
that's
the appearance life. Of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. What follows if that's true? Yeah, this forms a personality,
yeah.
A persona,
mm-hmm.
A mask.
Yeah.
That's what a personality is.
Yeah.
A persona is a mask.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Say, by the way, on occasion, do you talk to students in classes in psychology?
Yeah.
Oh, now you have a new idea you can introduce, can't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, will it not be received with great applause? Or shock, or what?
No, it's a good one. They like that kind of stuff. They love it. Yeah, right there with
that. I'm still wondering how taking on a likeness of enlightenment is providential.
Well,
like,
no.
Oh, yeah.
It's only providential within the family. The child then gets an honored role, gets a place in the family. It's seen as the right thing to do. It's seen as a benefit for the family that keeps the family together, neurotically, but still it keeps them together. It is not providential in this sense. Because it's over here that has to be a true good,
so
benefiting
like
the individual.
Fundamental thing that all humans go through this.
Yeah.
I haven't found a human that's free of
five
words.
Yeah, yeah, right. Because,
and all that stuff.
Yeah, okay, look, agreed? Providence is a good that meets the needs ideally of the person in their own development, right? And therefore that helps them in their own individual development. This cuts it off, but it stays within the family. Let's check to see whether that's true or not, shall we?
Yes.
Okay, Barbara, what do you think?
Sure.
There it is.
Yeah, I like what you're saying, and I'm almost convinced. But it looks like you're calling providence two different things.
Yes.
Or.
Yes.
Because originally providence was, I think, something that came from the divine and kept the integrity of the divine through who it's in.
That's right.
And now you're saying that the thing which we name for the higher, we can also name for the lower. And that's kind of, that's...
With a difference.
Unless we're not talking about the substance of providence, but only that it is a dynamic.
That's all.
And that the dynamic can be applied here, there, and everywhere.
That's right.
But does that belittle or belie what I've always associated with providence, which was an offspring of the good?
No.
And qualitatively so.
Oh, that's right. All it is the dynamics are similar.
The dynamics of?
Of providence exist on both levels.
Dynamics are similar.
The dynamics are similar. Is the language is similar?
We are seeing that the language is similar.
And is the substance similar?
And the substance is vastly different.
How can we do that? That's getting back to the...
But how can we do that?
Because that, by saying that, you have to ask, how can there be providence in something as tertiary and transitory as human existence?
That's right. It only has a value within the family. Let's ask the question. So, what's the consequence of going through that dream for you?
It made me realize why I have a dream. And it was very significant why I have a dream.
Is it in any way helpful? Very helpful. The logos is helpful to release people from the bonds of the personal problem that exhibits itself in such circumstances and such conditions. And now they have a new view of what's good, and a new view of the family, so that degree that they're able to integrate.
So rather than demean the quality of providence, we have to, let me find the right word, just a minute, it's coming, we have to celebrate the beauty of providence.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Very important. Yes, that's true. Right. Because it has, every problem has a beauty, has a precision, requires that everybody in it recognizes what's necessary for that to be accomplished, to have the consequences it must there to be. That's why if you have a good problem, you might be able to see that the parents chose the moment when the child was most open and accepting, and they seize on that moment as the moment to introduce the problem or the pathologo. It's not random. The greater the degree of freedom, right? Therefore, at whatever preceded that event at 5 years old, is most likely to be an occasion when you were open and free and engaging, and then they pounced on you. Because then you have to go back and say, what I thought was so important can't be that important. I have to give that up. By contrast with what I am now being revealed, what is being revealed to me looks like it's totally different and gives me a whole new way of looking at things. Therefore, you repudiate the state of mind you were in before, which invariably is positive. Yes. Pardon me. Totally agree.
So back to Josh's question, which is there anything providential about the pathological? Yes.
Yeah.
But there is something providential about applying the logos.
Well, yes, there's something providential about seeing.
Yeah.
In
that's true.
Look
here. See, we need a new word, which is pseudo-providence in the family. Pseudo, phony. In the same way, all of these qualities are pseudo, they're not real. Go ahead. Yes. Yeah. David?
You're basically saying man's folly follows the same rules as man's excellence. It's like, in other words, it's kind of like a game. The rules of the game apply. And in that way, there's something beautiful about man's fall and something that has integrity about it. For if it did not have that integrity, would there be any need to fulfill the needs of the game?
And if it didn't have the integrity, you wouldn't be able to the logos wouldn't be able there, to
there would be no cohesion to the game.
Right.
Therefore, no way to label the dynamics of it. Mm-hmm. And its consistency. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Try a new word. Usia.
Usia instead of providence, or usia?
Like you have to have the ability to reflect, to engage in that reflection for the logos to reveal itself in respect to the particular situation you're in.
So, it demands
you see it. Yeah, see, because it's very likely, you see, that at this moment when she was 5 years old, what happened before she was in an open state of mind, and therefore that openness could invite questions. This ends question.
Ends everything. I said it ends everything.
Yeah.
That's why it's so significant.
Pardon?
That's why it's so significant.
Yes, that's why it's so significant. Right. And what we mean by the word usia is the ability man has to reflect upon himself. That's the word, right? That ability makes us human. Therefore, we can then use the natural integrity of reason called the logos. But this, you see, this kind of reflection is cut off. Equally well, since you're shut up, you're taught, don't explore, don't give your point of view, don't share what you're thinking, which is so important to you. Cut it off. There goes the logos and the reflection upon problems. As you become a dutiful child in a family setting.
But just like, how did the parents know?
Pardon, do it again?
Just how do the parents know to act in that
way? Oh, they know because it was done unto them.
But it's so incredible that they respond with such vigor to that scene.
Okay.
That's it. Like, yeah. That's
a major point. Look here. Two things are important. There is absolutely no doubt that parents and their surrogates, right? Parents and surrogates, they clearly realize that they are doing what they are doing. What we can call playing out the game. But none of them know why they are doing what they're doing. The difference between that and why. They know that they're doing what they are doing, but they don't know why they're doing it, because it was done unto them in the same way they're doing it to you. And it goes all the way back to the caves. Therefore, there is a personal responsibility that they did it, but it doesn't help anything until they discover why they did what they did, which is to reveal in their own past what happened to them under similar circumstances. So it's always clear that they know what they're doing. They're not unconscious. But they are not conscious of why they're doing what they're doing.
I found several times made the point that providence in the family is providence only with providence in the papalogos of the family is only an image, a distorted image of providence in reality, and that just like there would be providence or reality that gave you a goodness and a benefit, that playing a certain role within the family unifies you within a structure that they will then recognize what you are doing as good and as for the best, right? And even if your role is to not, even if your role is that your state of mind is destroyed in order that your parents are in a high state of mind, or in the case of my family, that my mother was, you know, able to be, you know, do this magic dance for us all. So I had to give up my state of mind completely and be cut off and separate. Yet that role was a unified part of her capacity to be in a good state. And that role was for me to belong to the family. That's a good. Because up until that time, not only didn't I belong, I didn't know what membership was all about, but I didn't understand why what was happening was happening. And, I mean, I don't understand it on this level, but I do understand all the forming past scenes that led up to the final transmission. All those scenes then have a reason to take place, and it becomes a rational universe, even though it's a pseudo-rationality, even though it's a half-rationality, right? So, it seems like we keep losing sight of that. Because, yeah, I agree that it's very different from providence reality, or the providence that the Logos brings to our understanding of a dream or of a past scene. But it seems to me that if I look at my experience of what happened to me when I received a transmission, I regarded it as a good thing. I mean, at the time.
Sure.
Yeah.
I can have that.
Well, I was reflecting earlier personal experience, and I was reflecting why the parents would pick that moment so precisely.
Mm-hmm.
And it occurred to me that in the time, in the particular event that I was in at 3 years old, I described that very much like my mother described when she was 3 years old, that some event occurred to her. And it occurred to me that what she's doing to me is protecting me from what she was seeing, what she concluded to be in that mercy as bad.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, she's functioning providentially, or
isn't good, because she doesn't want me to be in that state that she experienced was negative, was treated as negative.
Without realizing.
Without, well, she doesn't have a memory of it. She didn't even see it, but to be that precise at that moment.
That's right.
It triggers in her that memory of herself, or what she experienced, although she doesn't remember it. She doesn't know why it occurred. She doesn't know the implications. All she knows is that state is bad. Because that's what she concluded.
And I think also that, like, some of my parents were destroying my state of mind, or destroying, you know, reducing me to a zero. That was the only time they paid any attention to me. That was the only time I got any conversation from them. So in that sense, it was like, wow, I exist. They see me, even though it's like.
Well, Gina just pointed to a trace of awareness. And Eldar's question was, how could they do that as if they were in any way aware? So what I'm wondering is there, can there be any trace of self-awareness or of any alternative while a Papalogos transmission is happening? He said, how could they do that as if they were actually doing that? And it seems like there's no they there if such a thing is happening. So I'm asking you, Eldar, is there any they there that could be doing that? If the implications are what we see about the Papalogos?
You mean as in, is there a they, as in, is there...
Any intention on committing whatever they're committing. Now I say committing because I couldn't think of a better word.
Like, in other words, is there a conscious awareness of the effects of what they're doing?
Yeah, and the implications.
No.
Such that you could ask, how could they do that?
No, because...
If they knew the implications, they would know why they're doing what they're doing.
Right.
And they wouldn't do it.
Right. But they do see that.
That's clear.
And so, they do see that they are doing it. Like, they regard the state of freedom and openness as dangerous to the family logos, and therefore dangerous for the child to have in terms of its own life. Like, it might go out in society and do something crazy from their estimation. So they have to cut off this sense, that state of freedom, openness, aliveness, in order to keep the child safe.
In their mind.
In their mind.
In their mind.
From their experience, because if they have to conclude that that state of mind is dangerous.
That's right.
And that has to come from their own experience.
Which part is dangerous?
That state of mind that they're cutting off.
The freedom, the openness.
They have to say in themselves what they experienced, that they experienced from their experience, that state of mind is dangerous.
Is that what they're identifying when they invoke this curse?
Yes. So as soon as they see it, they see it's dangerous for the kid. They're trying to protect the kid from something that they concluded was dangerous.
So there's no looking back to any other model.
No, they don't have another model.
They're not aware of having a model.
Right. They're not aware. Well, if it's not a nousia in the higher sense, it's not a nousia. It's almost like a reaction, remembrance or memory of some sort. But it's not reflecting.
What they were taught was dangerous.
Yes. Or no, what they concluded to be dangerous about the state when they were treated in a certain way. They came to a certain conclusion. And when they see their child in that state, they need to protect them. It's a loving game, but it's not.
But it ain't.
So there was such a high state in the child, such a high level of usia going on, that it caused this immediate reaction of the parents. So what amazes me is, how is it possible for the parents' interruption to override such a powerful usia?
That's right.
No.
Look, let me tell you. Many years ago, I was living in San Francisco, and I had my young children. So Peter, who is a very fine son, and he really had a real openness and was enjoying life. But I didn't think anything particular of it. But one day, I was coming up the steps from the outside, and I stood there at the platform, looking into the living room, and I couldn't figure out what the hell I was doing. I was just sitting there looking. And my son Peter was on a tricycle and the house going back and forth over the grate that we had heat coming up all the way from the open grate. And he was doing fine. And suddenly, for reasons which I never understood, I suddenly blew up and said, "What the hell are you doing that?" And I saw the kid was in shock. I never appeared that way before to him. For days after that, I said, "What the hell am I? Am I a monster or something? I mean, what's going on?" These kinds of reflections started this whole day. I had to walk around saying, "Hey, how do you make out? I mean, here's the kid I love. And I'm treating him like a criminal, or he did something terrible." Hey, just many years before I could say, "Wait a minute, he was in an open, free stage, and I must have been worried about that persisting, and I decided to turn it off." But that's reflecting. Hey, it took me nearly 10 years to make that connection.
Hallelujah.
But that's how it all started.
But to answer Elgar's question, why is it so, has such an impact over usia? Like in the positive state, the kid is in a usia-like state.
Sure.
But it has such a power impact because, remember, when it's early, it's 2, 3, 4, 5, and to stand up to a, what would you call, God, divine-like figure, like a parent.
I have to add one thing. Wait a minute. You have to add one thing. You have to recognize that at this point, it is absolutely the highest they have seen their parents.
Right.
In the sense of most powerful, most knowing. You have to put all those adjectives in there.
That age.
Yes.
That's important that it's at that age and not at, say, 10 or 15.
It won't work.
No,
it won't work.
But it's still, even so, it still seems like such a, I mean, we're talking about usia,
yeah.
Right? Like the most powerful thing there is.
The child doesn't have it yet.
Doesn't have what?
Or the logos. They're just emerging. This is the opening. This is when they're being exposed to these things. These things are now available, beginning to be available, and therefore someone wants to cut them off or to confine them within the family traditions.
They kill you.
Oh, are you saying,
is the alternative?
Are you
saying it's like a early developmental stage of usia.
Yes.
And what
if it was a
pasture.
So the
They have to also be at the age when they realize, like I think it was just well reported, you have to know that the consequences of something are going to be pretty horrendous. So that means you already have to have reached the point where you are aware of those things and have a right to fear them. I think you got it, though. It's it's an earlier stage. They have to see you reach that age where you can be challenging the game itself. That's very important.
I don't remember that scene that Barbara went through, but I know that throughout my life, to go over a certain line put me in absolute peril. The death-defying peril.
Yeah.
And they kept that over our heads most of our lives.
That's right.
And if we went outside the parameters.
Well, I thought I'd do this evening. Thank you for sharing. Tomorrow?
My place, please.
At his place.
Saturday at Dave's.
Thank you, guys. Okay. Now I'm going to get me a drink.
Nothing that has sweet chips.